See you. Well, good evening and welcome to worship tonight. And that was a lovely way to start our evening. Let's hear the word of God and we'll pray together as we prepare our hearts to worship. From Isaiah chapter 52, how beautiful on the mountains are the feet of him who brings good news, who publishes peace, who brings good news of happiness, who publishes salvation, who says to Zion, your God reigns. Let's pray. And we come to you, our reigning, majestic, glorious God. We bless you that you have from everlasting been God, and that underneath us are your everlasting arms of mercy, and that it is you who sends the word out and who proclaims peace and reconciliation to those who've once been alienated to you. You are the one who announces blessedness and happiness to those who once were estranged from you and now enter into that blessedness that is your own being. You are the one who publishes salvation to those who need rescued and brought back. And you are the one who declares that you are our God and that our God reigns over all. We pray that you would draw near to us tonight and establish your reign in our lives, in our minds, and amongst us as your people, we pray. In Jesus' strong name, amen.
Please remain standing and we will pray together the prayer of confession, which can be found in your bulletin. O God, our Father, we are gathered before you to worship you, awed by your majesty, greatness, and glory, and encouraged by your love. Yet there is a coldness in our hearts, a hardness towards you, an unwillingness to admit our sin and need for you. Forgive us for all our sins, for Jesus' sake. Come near and strengthen us by the work of your Holy Spirit until Christ reigns supreme within us in every thought, word, and deed. Give us a faith that overcomes the world, works by love, and fastens us to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Hear now the gospel's assurance of pardon. See what kind of love the Father has given to us, that we should be called children of God, and so we are. Be seated.
We begin a new preaching series tonight on the book of Mark. So turn with me in your Bibles to the book of Mark, page 837, if you're using the church Bible. The title of the series is Read, Mark, Learn. That phrase comes from an old prayer where we pray that God would help us to read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest the truth of God's word. But the word mark, of course, we're using here in reference to the writer of this volume. And can I just say that this series, which will last for a little while, based on Mark's gospel, would be an ideal series for you to bring any friends of yours who are unconvinced about the Christian message and expose them to the Jesus who is, and the Jesus who has spoken, and in being introduced to him, perhaps find him as their own Savior. But before we read, let's pray a prayer seeking God's illumination for our minds. Our God, we come to you and understand that our minds have been so distracted by the world around us. Our thinking is tending towards things away from you, always dragging us away from the things of God. And we need, Lord, your illumination. We need your Holy Spirit to open the eyes of our hearts that we might see, and to move our hearts to embrace and illumine our minds that they might understand the things that you have revealed in your holy word. Will you cast your light upon us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, we begin. In the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, as it is written in Isaiah the prophet, behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way. The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. John appeared, baptizing in the wilderness and proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And all the country of Judea and all Jerusalem were going out to him, and were being baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair and wore a leather belt around his waist and ate locusts and wild honey. And he preached, saying, after me comes he who is mightier than I, the strap of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Let us pray. Dear Father above, let us always abide in your Son, whom you have given to us as the greatest of gifts. We thank you for your love and care and pray you use these tithes and offerings that many more may follow Jesus, our Lord, here in Philadelphia and around the world. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Well, turn in your Bibles to Mark chapter 1. If you ever visit Rome, there's a street that runs from St. John's Lateran to the Colosseum. And on that street is the Church of San Clemente. Archaeologically speaking, it's a three-tiered complex of buildings. The present basilica was built before 1100. Beneath that is a 4th-century basilica converted out of a home, a villa, the home of a Roman nobleman, part of which had in the first century served as an early church. And in the basement, there is the first century street with all the tiles still intact, with a water fountain, with a Mithraic temple, and with the remains of a villa that had been destroyed by the great fire of Rome in the year 64. A.D. The home was Clement's home. Clement is mentioned by St. Paul, and it was most likely that Clement grew up there in that villa, and that there the early church worshipped in his living room. And it was probably in that living room that one of the very first readings of the book of Mark would have been heard. Certainly the preaching that led to the book of Mark would have been heard in that and in other churches in the city of Rome at that time. It seems as if this book appears after the great fire. The fire destroyed about 80% of the city. And in the clamor to shift blame, Nero chose to focus the collective fury of the populace on Christians. They were arrested, clothed in skins of wild animals and thrown to the wild dogs who tore them apart. Others were dipped in pitch or tar, fastened to poles and set afire in order to illuminate the arena or Nero's private gardens, while still others were fed to the lions in the Colosseum for mass entertainment. That is the context in which Mark's gospel was written. Whether he started the gospel before Peter died, we don't know. But certainly Peter is the influence behind the writing of Mark's gospel. And I imagine this evening the people gathering, since I've been there, the people gathering in Clement's living room, in perhaps the ruins of Clement's villa, to hear Mark's gospel for the very first time. John Mark was a native of Jerusalem. His family may have frequently entertained Jesus. And Mark had early on embraced Jesus as Lord. He may be the young man who appears at various points referenced in the gospel story. Mark holds a distinction. He was fired by Paul, as R.C. Sproul puts it. He was rehired by Barnabas, and eventually he became Peter's right-hand man. And his gospel is distinct from the other gospels and, quite frankly, very distinct from the sermons you're going to hear. His gospel is marked by brevity and by drama and by its fast pace. He uses the word, in fact, immediately, over and over again, to move us quickly on from one story to the next. He's a man in a hurry. He has something to say. He says it clearly and quickly, and he hurries us to the conclusion at the end of the book. I'm going to make a prophecy. We will not go as fast as Mark goes. Mark begins then. Look at your text. He begins at the beginning, literally at the beginning. The very first word is beginning in the Greek. Beginning the gospel of Jesus Christ, Son of God. You might have in your mind, since you know the Bible so well, echoes of the beginning in Genesis. In the beginning, God created. You might want to tie up the dots and think, well, this beginning of the gospel is the beginning of a new creation. It's something brand new in the history of the world, breaking in to the old creation and starting off this new thing that is happening in world history. There's also a contrast between Mark and the other gospels. When Matthew begins his gospel, he begins with Jesus' family tree and traces Jesus' background back through David, the king, to Abraham, the father of the nation. Luke, on the other hand, he traces Jesus' genealogy back to the very, very beginning of history with the first couple, with Adam and Eve, our first forebears. John goes even further. He pushes back beyond Abraham, back beyond Adam and Eve, back into eternity when he's describing the one who was in the beginning with God and who is God. But Mark, on the other hand, wants to get to the gospel, and he wants to get to the gospel quickly. And so he begins, beginning the gospel, the good news. This is what Christianity is about. It's good news. You may be used to hearing bad news things about the church or about Christianity, but in fact, it's about the good news of the gospel. Here, these words were most likely the preface, I think, to this build-up to Jesus' baptism. The baptism there is the first great event in the public life of Jesus. It's very important. We'll look at it next time, But here is the setup for that introduction. And he begins by taking us right to the very heart of the gospel. He begins with his conclusion, in other words. He begins like this. He's up front. Jesus, Messiah, Son of God. You want to summarize what the gospel's about? The gospel is Jesus, Messiah, Son of God. Look at those words with me for a moment. You think you know what each of those words means. Taken together, they express how important the gospel is. Jesus, Yeshua. It was a common enough name. There's a Yeshua in the Old Testament. Joshua, who leads the children of Israel into the promised land. Jesus, in the Greek. But you need to hear what this sounded like to someone in Jesus' day who heard the name Jesus. What did they hear when they heard that name? It was a composite name. It's made up of two parts. One is the intimate name of God, the intimate name of God that flows out of the encounter Moses had in the wilderness when he met God and he asked God, "Whom shall I say is sending me?" And God gives him this statement, "I am that I am." The name Lord, when you're reading the Old Testament in English, whenever you see all uppercase letters, or for any English people here, capital letters, when you see capital or uppercase letters, that name is the English form of the Hebrew word Yahweh, sometimes mispronounced Jehovah. And the second word is the word to save. So it's Jehovah saves, or the Lord saves. So you meet Jesus in the street and you ask him, "What's your name?" "The Lord saves." That's the impact of his name. The Lord saves. "I am the Lord, your God, the Holy One of Israel. He is the Lord who saves." And when we read the name Jesus, Jesus means God with us. We read that in Matthew's gospel. Jesus means God with us to save, to rescue his people from their sins. Christ. Christ is the Greek form of the word Messiah. It means literally the anointed one. So, who are you? Well, I'm the Lord saves, the anointed one. Jesus Christ. That's what people would have understood. That's what the word means. It was the priests of Israel and the kings of Israel who were anointed for their office. They were anointed with water, or anointed with oil to their office. But Isaiah the prophet, when he was predicting the future, Isaiah predicted a time when the Lord God himself would come. He would come as the Lord who is the servant. And the Lord who is the servant would be the Lord Messiah, because he would be anointed, not with oil or with water, but with the Holy Spirit. In Luke's gospel, Luke has Jesus going to a synagogue very early on, a synagogue in his own hometown of Nazareth, and he goes in there and he's handed the scroll of the day. He opens the scroll and he reads the words for that day's reading. "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord Jehovah has anointed me to bring good news, the gospel, to the poor, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God." And Jesus, having read that, says, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." Because this one who comes, who's God's anointed one, is going to be anointed with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit proper to him, the Spirit of sonship. So he is Jehovah saves, the Lord who saves, the Anointed One. This historical figure comes to save us as only God can save us. He who possesses the Holy Spirit without measure is in fact the Son of God. There's a progression, you see. He's the Lord who saves. He is anointed with the Holy Spirit without measure. He is the Son of God. Used here, this description is not simply a repetition of the word Christ, as in some popular writing today. The word Christ signifies the anointed, prophet, priest, king. The word Son of God does not suggest that. He will be designated Son in verse 11 and in chapter 9, verse 7, by God himself. He will be acknowledged. You are the Son of God by demons. The demons recognize that he is the Son of God by nature, not simply by adoption or by office. Jesus himself will bear witness to his divine sonship. He's guarded at first, finally expresses it before the Supreme Court of Israel later on in chapter 14. And Mark's gospel will reach its climax when a Roman centurion at the cross confesses, "This man is the Son of God." So his names and titles define who he is. He is the Lord who saves. He is the Spirit-anointed Savior. And he is God's very Son, sharing God's very nature from all eternity. It is he who is incarnate, who's in a body and moving around Palestine and preaching. Mark is declaring that he's declaring his hand right at the very beginning. He's laying his cards on the table. This is where he's going to take us. This Yeshua, this the Lord saves, this Anointed One is the Son of God. And as his gospel goes on, you will find, in the language of Thomas Wynandy, you will find Jesus becoming Jesus. The one who's called the Lord who saves, increasingly during his life, demonstrates that he has come to do just that. He lives out his name. He saves us. He saves people. His saving acts will culminate at the cross and in the resurrection. And the more he does that, the more he demonstrates that he is the Son of the Father, until his resurrection brings the final authentication, when he is declared to be the Son of God with power through the resurrection of the dead. That is the heart of the gospel. The heart of the gospel is the Lord saves, the Anointed One, the Son of God, Jesus, Messiah, Son of God. But then Mark goes on to give us the context of the gospel. The gospel did not begin de novo, out of the blue, out of thin air, in first century Palestine. It had already had an origin in Scripture, and so Mark immediately points us to the prophets. He quotes Isaiah the prophet, because Isaiah's the number one prophet. He's the biggest of all, and he kind of represents all the prophets. And he's going to quote exactly from Isaiah, but his first quote actually comes from Malachi, or better known as the great Italian prophet Malachi. Anyway, that didn't go down because you're half asleep. Sunday evening crowd is always half asleep. So listen to what he says. "Behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his paths straight." Mark is quoting from Malachi 3, verse 1, and Isaiah 40, verse 3. Now, in the Malachi, the passage, Mark adds these words. He adds the words, "before your face," and the word your way. Both in Malachi and in Mark, the I who speaks is God, the Lord God of Israel. In Mark's account, the Lord God of Israel is speaking of another your. Instead of God sending a messenger to prepare the way for him coming, as Malachi puts it, Mark says God is preparing a way for someone else to come. The messenger is John the Baptist, and the face before whom he is coming is the face of Jesus Christ. So here's how Mark describes it. God the Father is sending John to prepare the way for his son. Here's how someone has written about this, and you need to follow this very closely to grasp what's going on in this little passage here. Because the original speaker in Malachi and Mark is God, and because within Malachi, God tells of a messenger coming before me, I will send my messenger before me, when Mark changes me to your, he's implying that the one for whom the way is being prepared is God, equally God. If the referent for the your in Mark is in any way inferior to the me in Malachi, in the prophecy, then the prophecy isn't fulfilled. God sends somebody else instead of coming himself. The prophecy is not fulfilled. For the one whose way is being prepared by God is not God. But Mark is saying the contrary. He's teaching us that the message is preparing the way for God's own coming. God is going to come, and God is coming in the way in which Mark now teases out for us. Mark's first sentence, those opening words are crucial to understanding what Mark is teaching us from Malachi here. Jesus Christ, the Son of God. So this is how Mark then goes back to Malachi, and this is how he understands what Malachi is saying. The I is Father, God the Father. The messenger is John. Your face and your way refer to Jesus, the Son of God. So that when Mark changes before me in Malachi to before your face, the your of which he speaks is Jesus. And it designates Jesus as God because the original me is God. Do you get that? You got that? Good. Mark takes Malachi seriously. I will send my messenger before me. But he's learned from Isaiah, as we'll see, that God coming as God means God coming as Son of God. Now, this prophecy had been fulfilled, therefore, because God the Father had sent the promised messenger, John the Baptist, who is now going before the face of God Jesus, by way of preparing the way. The one sending, the Father, and the God being prepared for, the Son, are one. They're distinguishable, but they're one God. And the key to understanding how you can distinguish them is the name Son in verse 1. The name Son prepares us to understand the name Father when it applies to God. And the Son who is God now comes and possesses a human face, Jesus. Now all of that from Malachi is confirmed by the second quotation that comes from Isaiah 40. Once again, this chapter starts with God comforting his people. He speaks good news to them. He tells them the gospel. He speaks tenderly to Jerusalem. He announces to Jerusalem that her warfare is ended and that her iniquity is pardoned. Jerusalem has been at odds with God. There's been alienation between Jerusalem and God. And here is God announcing to Jerusalem, the warfare is ended, alienation is over, peace has broken out between you and me. Why is that? Because your iniquity is pardoned. The thing that caused the breach, the thing that creates the barrier, that has been dealt with. Your iniquity is pardoned. And not only that, on the positive and plus side, she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. Mercy, grace will be doubled. Not only does she get pardoned, not only is she reconciled, but she gets double portions of mercy and blessing from God in his grace. So there's a great announcement of the forgiveness of sins. And you'll see that John talks about that from verse 4 onwards. It's an announcement of the gospel. And in Isaiah 40, that is followed immediately by a reference to the messenger, just as Malachi did. In the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. John the Baptist went down to the wilderness of Jordan, and there on the banks of the river Jordan, he preached, and people went down to the wilderness to see John the Baptist. In the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Those are the words that Matthew draws on in our text. Mark is telling us that the gospel of Jesus Christ, Son of God, marks the fulfillment of this prophecy of the forgiveness of sins and the doubling of grace and kindness and mercy from God to men and women. Mark is pointing us to John, who is the messenger, sent into the desert to prepare the way of the Lord, to make straight, quoting Isaiah, to make straight in the desert a highway for our God. So what is Isaiah preparing us for? He's preparing us for one who's coming, who is the Lord and who is God. And the messenger, John the Baptist, when he comes, the messenger will be in the business of getting people ready for the arrival of the Lord who is our God. And Mark brings these two quotations together from Malachi and Isaiah to teach us what is really going on in the gospel. The one who sends, in verse 2, is the Father. We know that from the Son language of verse 1. He gives a voice to his messenger, the messenger that he sends, John the Baptist. He commissions John to be the one who will speak about the Lord, our God. That is Jesus. God the Father gave these prophecies that have now been fulfilled in God the Son. Both the Father and the Son are God. That's important. When you add the Father and the Son, they come to one God. One God. So that when Jesus comes, we can say God came. God came. John the Baptist then fulfills his mission. Here we get the preaching of the gospel. Matthew tells us that John preached, "Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand." It was at hand because the king was at hand. Jesus was at hand to establish his kingdom. Matthew and Luke quote from Isaiah 40 and to declare that Jesus is the Lord whom Isaiah led us to expect. Isaiah goes on to say, "And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together." Luke adds, "And all flesh shall see the salvation of the Lord." So here we have him. Mark introduces us to him. Here we have the Lord who saves, Jesus, who is the anointed one with the Holy Spirit, the Christ, who has come into the world as the Son of God to enact his own name, to be the Savior, to bring salvation, including the forgiveness of sins, and the doubling grace and mercy and kindness that comes from God. Now, what does this mean for you and me? This means for you and me that we cannot begin to think about the Christian message. We cannot begin to think about the good news without reflecting on the fact that it's about Jesus, and that Jesus is very God of very God. Why is that important? Why is it crucial? It's crucial for our salvation. Why has he come into the world? Well, he's come into the world to teach. Well, if we're going to listen to his teaching, we want it to be the very word of God. We want God to speak to us. And we hear God speak to us when Jesus speaks to us. But above all, he's come to make a sacrifice of his human nature in his human flesh on the cross. And it's the fact that he is both God and man that makes his sacrifice so valuable, of infinite value. It makes what he does for us on the cross absolutely vital, and it means that it is absolutely and unquestionably effective for our salvation. His death is not the death of a mere man. His death is the death of the God-man, who with his own blood, in fact, you can even say, because God is in Christ, that it was God's blood. God doesn't have blood, but in Christ, God has blood in the human nature of the Son. This man is God over all, forever blessed, Paul says in Romans chapter 9. We need a Savior who is able to save to the uttermost everybody who comes to God by him. And Mark is announcing, John is proclaiming that this one has arrived. John's dress is mentioned in verse 6 there. It's not fashionable, it's not J. Crew, certainly not Brooks Brothers, but he's wearing this very strange garment that reminds us of the Old Testament prophet Elijah. Malachi had promised this, "Behold, I send you Elijah the prophet before the great and terrible day of the Lord." This great and terrible day of the Lord, Yahweh, the Lord, has come because the Lord saves has come. Jesus has come. That great terrible day is a day of judgment on sin. That's why John preaches repentance. He preaches repentance because there's a time to judge sin. He preaches a repentance for the forgiveness of sins. You see, judgment goes two ways. The great and terrible day of the Lord is a day of judgment, and judgment works two ways. It works one way in justification, and it works another way in condemnation. The arrival of Jesus meant the terrible day of the Lord in which judgment begins. And it results in verdicts of us being put right with God on the one hand, or being condemned eternally on the other. And it all hinges around the person of Jesus Christ. That's what the gospel is about. So John comes preaching repentance for the forgiveness of sins. For those who repent and are baptized, are being readied for the coming day when the Lord saves. Jesus saves. This day of judgment brings both justification and condemnation. It tells us many were going out to him and were baptized in the River Jordan, confessing their sins. They in their own hearts were condemning them. They were confessing their sins in order to find the forgiveness of sins. And those who came to be baptized by John recognized in Jesus God's just condemnation of sin. And those who rejected it opted out of God's saving justice and were closed up to the terrible day of God's wrath. And because Jesus is anointed with the Holy Spirit, because he is the Christ, John says he is mightier than him. This is the principal work of the gospel minister, to do as John does, and that is to set Christ before the people as the Son of God and as God the Son. I could tell you stories of Jesus that left you thinking of him merely as a good man, a kind man, and a loving man. But I'd be failing you if I didn't bring your attention to the fact that this man, with all of those things true of him, is the God-man. He is God. John Newton once wrote a poem that says this: "What think you of Christ is the test. To try or to test and to show your state, whether you're right with God or not, and your scheme, that is, whether your thoughts of God are right. You cannot be right in the rest until you think rightly of him. As Jesus appears to your view, as he is beloved or not, so God is disposed towards you, and mercy or wrath is your lot." The issue will always be, what think you of Christ? Jesus, the Lord saves. Christ, God's anointed with the Spirit. Son of God, God the Son. Father, we pray that tonight you would open our hearts to this one whom Mark introduces right at the very beginning of his gospel, putting his cards on the table before us. This is where we're going. This is who this is. We pray, Lord, that you would melt our hearts before him, that you would draw out of our hearts love for him, joy in him, that the Lord Jesus would appear to our view in all the beauty and all the love that is his nature, because God is love. We see that in human terms, in his humanity. God is love. We see in Jesus the double grace that you have brought into our lives. We pray that we might experience that double grace, that double kindness, that double blessedness that comes to those who trust in him. In his name we pray. Amen. Now may grace, mercy, and peace from God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest and remain with you now and evermore. Amen.